Like to thank everybody for showing up. I appreciate the support. This is my very first live stream for Custom Creative Carvings. This is Behind the Carvings. We're gonna dive into a spire and we're gonna take an average block of wood. This is a cutoff of Baltic birch that I had from a project a while back. This is the block I'm designing tonight. And where we're gonna get is to a catch-all tray. So this is a cherry one that I made over the past few days, and this is a walnut one that I made a couple weeks ago. Great thing to make, great gifts. Easy to throw a monogram into them and personalize them. The great thing about catch-all trays is they're something that an experienced CNC worker or experienced woodworker can make, but it's also something that could be very entry level. And because this is entry level, I am gonna start from the very beginning, and that is the setup in a spire. Now I am using a spire 10.5, a spire 11's out. Everything I do tonight should be the same, whether you're using a spire 10.5, 11, 9, even if you're on one of the other Vectric platforms. So I'm throwing this out there as a Vectric tutorial, not an Aspire tutorial. Everything I'm doing will be 2D. Carving, maybe a little bit of 2.5D. So as we jump into our setup, we file new. First, we got to do job type. Not doing anything on the back of these. While I do have a round over here, I did round over top and bottom on these with a table router. So you could program those in and do this as a double-sided. That's getting a little bit deeper than we're going to go into today. So single-sided, take our measurements. This block, we got 9 wide, 6 3/4 on the y-axis, and 1 1/8 thick. Now, computer and CNC like decimals. I don't have my decimals down to the 64th memorized, but I can read a tape measure down to the 64th. Usually I'll grab my caliper and get that, but if I'm in a hurry and can't remember what the decimal equivalent of 3/4 is, I can type in 6/6 3/4 and hit the equal button on the keyboard. And that will convert that to the decimal for me. So makes it really easy. It's a great feature that Aspire puts into their, or Vectric puts into their products. So very simple setup. You could do this in metric, but I'm doing it in standard because that's the way my brain works. Metric is an easier system, but everything I've ever done in woodworking has been standard, so I go with standard. The reason I'm going with machine bed on this is because as I finish these trays up, I do a radiused edge on these. So I cut these out down to the base, and anytime I'm cutting to my spoil board, I use the machine bed as my my surface. If I'm only doing a v-carve in the top, that is when I will use material surface. But this one, I'm digging down into it all the way to the bed, so I'm going to use machine bed. Datum position, I'm just going to keep it here in the bottom left because that's where I like it. And then I'm, as far as resolution, this comes in play when you're doing very fine detailed work and 3D carving where you want that really high resolution. This is going to be slow enough as is tonight, so I'm going to leave it fastest. And I said I'm doing birch, but I'll leave it at pine. So here we've got our base material. Now I've got this digitally in the computer. So where I always start on my catch-all trays is basic rectangle. And I could do the math all before, but I like to just start with that, come in here, and I use a 1/4 inch spiral cutter to cut my outside edge. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to radius this external. I'm going to do a 1 inch radius, and I'm going to do my 9 by 6.75, except I'm going to go minus 0.5. And then minus 0.5. Yes, I could just do that all in my head, but when it starts getting into the more complex, you know what, I'm gonna minus a 1/64. Makes it a lot easier to just be able to use the calculator function in there. Now I hit apply on that. This is gonna give me my base outline. So this will be my final cutout but it also gives me my idea of where I'm going. Now I want to take that and I want to leave enough of a lip here for a round over. So if you do a quarter inch there, it makes it a nice tight lip, but then you're going to be round over with sandpaper because you put a quarter inch round over on that and you're going to lose it. So I like to go half an inch on each side. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to come down and minus one on each of these. You get too used to doing the offsets, which you don't have to click on it. You just do again and again. So now we've got our outside diameter and the inside of our tray. So those are our two. The important thing about keeping this radius here is we want to keep that radius bigger than the radius of our cutter. So right now I could use a 2-inch bit to run this and I could clear this out with a 2-inch bit. You shift select this, you can go back in and edit these. So I prefer a 1.25 inches. That is my go-to clearing bit and my go-to bowl and tray bit. So I want the radius of that. So I'm just going to go with that and make that a 0.625. And that gives me a little bit tighter radius in here, which gives it kind of a matching look to the bigger radius on the outside. So now I've got those two. I'm going to come in here and do another, but I'm going to make this one a little bit smaller still. I'm going to do this one minus 0.625, and then do this one minus 0.625. Now the reason I'm doing this is because what this gave me was this gives me the center line of the 1.25 inch bit that we'll be doing this cut out right here. So now I can use this as a third tool path. And I'll show you why I did that here in a minute. But as far as my square tool paths or my rectangle tool paths, those are the only three you need to make these either of these two trays that I just made. Last thing you are gonna need if you decide to go there is a little bit of text. Trojan Pro, one of my favorite texts. I'm gonna go all kinds of fancy and throw my initials in there. I'm gonna do them a little proud and drop them right there. So keep in mind, this is the center line of this outside cutter. So you can get closer to that. But if I get any closer to that, now using a 1-inch diameter V bit, if I get any closer than that, then I'm running the risk of hitting this wall right here. But I know I've got a 0.625 offset, so a 1-inch V bit is going to have a half-inch diameter, half-inch radius. That's not going to reach this wall right there, so I can put that down to that extra little bonus in there of having that line to know how close I can get. So I've got everything I need to complete the design of this. Thank you for that like button, married man, and thank you for helping everybody else remember to do that too. I would have forgotten, too much on my mind right now, so appreciate you looking out. So right up here, I'm going to switch to tool paths commands. So now I've switched over to this side and I'm going to come in and start with this one right here. This is what I do for my clean out, because for this one, I'm going to use a bowl and tray. And what I found is those bowl and trays, even though they come down with their radius, let me see, I've got CAD software. I can actually draw this. So they've got their radiuses on each side. What I found is quite often, instead of them coming flat across like that, what they'll do is they'll come down, this is greatly exaggerated, to a point. And so as you do carves with this, you're gonna have mounds between your step over. And I like to do really big step overs on this because you don't have to have a tight step over with a flat bit. So what I do is I will actually use a flat bit for this. So I'm gonna start with this one. with a pocket tool path. I've got my quarter inch end mill. No, let's select. On this, I'm going to start with a surface planing, 1¼. Now I'm running this 16,100 feed rate. That is way too slow. I should be going a lot faster than that for that. But know your feeds and speeds. I usually end up bumping it up after I get to the machine because I forget to change it here. We're gonna select that, bring it down. Start depth is 0. Cut depth, with this, it's 1¼ thick. So honestly, I would probably surface plane that a little bit down first, but I'm gonna assume that I've already planed this and flattened this and I'm ready to mill it with the CNC, or mill this out into a tray. So 1¼, I'm probably gonna go, let's do Z times 0.75. So I'm gonna cut 3/4 of the material out. That's what I love about doing the math in this, is you can reference any axis, your X, Y, or Z axis in this. Say I wanna make something half my Y axis. You can do a Y times 0.5 and it'll cut that in half. So I'm going 3/4 of the way down this and it's gonna give me that number right there. Now I come in, passes 5. Yeah, we'll do 5. I was hoping I could get it down to 1/4, but being 1¼, that gives me weird numbers. All right. So ramping, one of my mentors has said, if you like your bits, always ramp. Makes your bits last longer, so I always ramp, and I always try and go at least half the distance of the bit, or half the diameter of the bit, so at least the radius. On this, I'll just go a little bit more than that. Pocket allowance, not worried about that. Save Z, and we're gonna call this the clear out, because I'm clearing out all the material there. Calculate that. Before I hit play on that, I'm gonna come back and check out the 2D. Okay. Dave, great question. Dave's asked if it would just be easier to offset. The answer to that is absolutely. If we came down to our offset toolpath and said we want to offset this by, what was I doing? 1.25 divided by 2. Oh wait, no, the first one was just a 1/2 inch offset. So offset by 0.5 inward. And this will show you why I don't do this. Okay, we're gonna offset that by 0.5, and the next one we wanna offset by 1.25 divided by 2, and then we're gonna offset this. Okay, so now what we've done as we've come in here, here's our original and we came into the offset. The radius on this, the offset one, is not a, or the diameter, yeah, the radius is not 1/2 inch. It's actually a tighter radius because it's going reference off this. And this one here comes even tighter, and that's drawn because it's coming down at an angle, bringing it in tighter and tighter each time, even though I didn't do the tight offsets. So if I create new rectangles each time, I get to control that radius. So that is why I do that. It does work. One way that you could do it if you're not worried about these outside radiuses is you start with your inside radius and then work your way out. And that's just gonna make your radius bigger and bigger each time. And so if we go outward, offset that one, and then offset that one, you start gaining this huge radius that to me just doesn't look like it was planned in well. So I feel it gives it a much more natural look if you build these with new squares. But that's why I do it that way. You're absolutely right, Dave. It would be quicker and easier to just use the offset vector. And I used to use that for just about everything, but then I realized I was running into this being too tight of a radius. And so now it's gonna go in and clean that up with a different tool. or it's going to leave parts uncut. But we've got this first one, and we're just going to carve that one out. This is just a clean out. Next tool path we're going to do is this one. This one, I just do a profile tool path because it only has to cut that one. This is that 1¼. I'm going to use my 1¼ bowl and tray. And this one, I'm also doing Z times 0.75. I always do that. I'll hit enter instead of equals. Enter does not do the same thing. Okay, there we go. Our 0.84, yada, yada, yada. 4 passes. This is one you got to be careful of. Notice how this went outside. Definitely want this inside, or it's going to mess some things up. Depending on the wood, I will do a separate last pass if it's a hardwood, because I've noticed when I hit that big chunk on the harder woods, it does tear out. So a separate last pass can make a little bit cleaner there. Don't worry about tabs. Always ramp. 30 degrees sounds good. And this is the bowl carve. We calculate that one. Now notice this one's going to come right along the same line as this one, except it hits that corner because the rounded bit is going to match the inside of that radius. And that's where the building a new one comes in, because I know that's going to be a sharp corner when it hits it there. Makes it so much quicker as the machine's moving, because this will slow down a lot when you hit those corners. That 90 degree, not nearly as much slowdown. And then the last tool path we're going to do for this one is going to be our cutout. Again, profile tool path. This one we're going Z. Quarter inch end mill. Now notice I've got this set at 300. I've got a note in here of my softwood speed. I'll run this at 528 on a softwood. For birch, I probably would run it at that. My last couple trays I've been doing at walnut and cherry, the harder woods, so I definitely do them slower. I put my safe speed here, and I save my crazy speed and just put that up in the notes so I know to come back to that later if I am doing something that is a little bit lighter. So 9 passes. This one I will do a separate last pass, and I'm just going to do a 10th thou, and that's going to give me a clean edge, because these 9 passes are each going to leave a little tiny line, and you can go and sand those off. Found that last pass, taking that 10th thou off, knocks that line out and just gives it a lot cleaner look, a lot less sanding. Of course, we're going to do our ramps, and then this one is going to be cut out. Now, I am programming this with the intent of using double-sided tape to tape this down. I found double-sided tape works fantastically. The other option would be I could screw this down, or I could use some low profile clamps. There's a lot of different options. If you're securing this some way other than securing this center, I would definitely recommend that you do something to secure the outside and the inside, maybe tabs or something. Leave an onion skin on the bottom that you can take off with that round over bit that you're going to be clear doing the radius on the bottom anyway after you get it out on the router. So I'm going to hit preview on this, and this is where we get a chance to talk. So as I'm hitting preview on this, because it's going to take forever, where are you from? where's everybody from? So let's, how far is our reach here tonight? Drop where you're from in the comments, and we'll do some shout outs by states. Two Elms is saying that we must have a little bit of power on my machine. I do have an industrial, well, almost industrial grade machine. It's got a 6 horse router. I do have the Maverick 4x8. That thing is amazing. I realize it's not everybody's in everybody's budget, and so I try and stick to smaller projects, and a lot of times I'll try and stick to cutting at a little bit slower speeds, or at least doing projects that are capable to be done on the smaller machines. But absolutely, I've absolutely loved the 4x8 and that really powerful spindle. So we're going to run through all the passes of the clear out first. And as we go through this, one thing I will note with programs like Mach 3, there are limitations. It will let you set your machine to 500 inches per minute, but as you hit run, it's not actually going to move at 500 inches per minute. There are limitations. I believe I was told that that's around 250 inches per minute. This is a good safety thing, because, well, you don't want to run your machine faster than it can anyway. My machine tops out at 1200 inches per minute, which is nice. I have done some surfacing, just taking a very thin layer off MDF with 2-inch cutter, 24,000 RPMs, with a running that up over 900 inches per minute. And it is crazy to see that that go at that speed. So let's see. Bourbon Dad signing in from Nampa, Idaho. Welcome, welcome. Two Elms signing in for from Minnesota. Whereabouts in Minnesota? I had a friend from the UP back in Iraq. So Roger Brown, welcome from Maine. Married man coming in from South Carolina, done some training down there. Dave, Melbourne, Australia. Welcome, welcome. Let's see, the offset for that's gotta be, yeah, halfway around the planet. Is that a 12-hour offset? Is it early morning for you up there in Melbourne? It's summer for you, isn't it? It is 38 degrees in my shop right now. You're probably nice and warm down there this time of year, or warming up. So, all right. So this is getting that clean out. The thing about using a surfacing bit, and the reason I do this is because that saves so much more time on this to go with that second tool. Now, if you don't have a auto tool change, or you don't have a really good touch off pad, it may not be worth it to use two separate tools for this. But if you've got that luxury of the touch off pad and you can hit that using the clean out or the surfacing bit, that's going to give you that nice flat surface, is a lot better than a bowl and tray that might leave a little bit of a ridge in the middle that you're going to have to sand out later. Mankatoa, South Central, okay. Not familiar too much with that area, but welcome, welcome. RC Builder coming in from Colorado Springs. You guys gotten snow up there yet? I spent some time in Colorado Springs back in, what was it, 03? Okay, 1:30 in the afternoon. Okay, so you guys are behind us, mid-afternoon. Okay, I was gonna say, if it's 1 o'clock in the morning there, my hat's off to you for tuning into this. All right, so we're done with the clear out. This is where the bowl and tray is gonna come in. And because we've got that tight radius on the corner, or that right radius on the corner, it's gonna do a perfect clean out on that. If you don't use the right, you might get a little tiny corner in here that you gotta sand back out. Now we've got our cutout coming. And so this is our final tool path. That's how easy these catch-all trays are to make. I completely skipped into tool path. So normally before I do that cutout, I've got one tool path left. And I can, because this is virtual, I can throw it on later. I forgot to do my v-carve, but I'll just throw my, on shallow ones, I don't like using the 30 degree, because then I've got to do a flat bottom. But with this font, I can bring my 60 degree in, and I don't have to do a flat bottom. I can run that in there Don't need a clearance. And I don't think I did that right. Okay, that's one thing you gotta be careful of when you're doing this V-carve, is this right here. You need to make that start depth at whatever your flat bottom is down here. So when you calculate that, it starts down at that bottom depth. All right, this is a great thing about running this. You can double check. I must have missed my calculation somewhere because I'm hitting here. And that tells me that I need to bump that up well out of that corner. I'll have to look back at my math later on that one and see why I came so close. But simple enough, just bring it up and out. Recalculate it. I'm not going to reset preview because then I'm going to have to go through all that hold again. But I'm going to preview visible, and we're looking to see if that is going to kiss it here when it comes down to the bottom of the J. Another way to fix this would be don't use a 1-inch V-bit. This could be done with a 1/4-inch V-bit, no problem, because I'm just barely getting in there. Another thing you want to check is your max cut depth. So right here, my max cut depth on this V-carve is 0.932. Got 1 1/4, so that leaves me more than 1/4-inch of material underneath that, so that's more than enough. If that came to, for example, if you came in here with a 30-degree and ran this with a 30-degree V-bit, that's going to cut real deep. That's going 1.033, that's getting really thin. That's where you may want to do a flat bottom on that. So that's the basics of doing this. One thing that I found is as we start optimizing our tool paths with the tools we have, we could do this and carve this 3D with a 1/8-inch tapered ball nose. Not only would it take forever to design, but it's going to take forever to cut. I can do all these in 13 minutes. And I'm not running these feeds too fast. Some of these were a little bit fast. We'd probably be looking at 20 minutes if I was using a 20 minutes to a half an hour if I was using like a Shapoko or an X-carve. But it's still capable to be done. So That's the basics of this. I do want to dive a little bit deeper in an upcoming episode about how to do contours or to use multiple bits to give yourself really flourished contours instead of using 3D tool paths or tapered bald nose, because they take so much longer. So keep an eye out. I'm going to try and do these on a weekly basis. We'll see if Wednesdays work for the regular. I know there's a couple other things that normally happen on Wednesday, and we'll see if that conflicts, but I wanted to get this out before Thanksgiving. I appreciate everyone coming and giving your input, asking your questions, and shouting out from all over the planet. That is awesome, reaching all the way down under here. Thank you everyone for showing up. I know it is a busy week. I hope everybody has a fantastic Thanksgiving. Happy holidays to everybody. Thanks for sticking around to the first edition of Behind the Carvings with Custom Creative Carvings. I'm Chris. Have a great evening.